And good morning, everyone. Good morning. So another beautiful day in Central Florida. You can't argue with that, huh? Here we are. So we want to welcome you on the Lord's Day here at North Citrus Christian Church, and glad that you are here with us. I think that God brought you here. I really firmly believe that. And I think that God has plans for our lives to work together and to do life together. And we're glad that you're here with us this morning to worship and to keep our focus and attention on Him. If you are visiting here for the first or second time or something, we'd love to have just some information, a little connect card that you can find right there in the pocket in front of you, just kind of name, address, phone number. That'd be great if we could just get that information from you. I do want to let you know that we do not pass a plate for offering. So if anybody is wanting to give your gifts, our regular attenders and members, give the tithes and offerings just by the buckets on either side. I say buckets. They're not buckets. They're wooden boxes that are attached to the wall. So you got wooden boxes in the back and on the sides. So feel free to put your Connect card in there along with any other offerings or gifts. Of course, you can always check on the back of the bulletin. Actually, it's not on the back anymore, but there's a little QR code there that you can access. It'll take you to the website for giving as well. We also want to welcome those of you that might be watching online. We're glad to offer our services back on Facebook and YouTube on our channel at North Citrus Christian Church. So encourage you to come and worship with us every Sunday morning at 10:30. So lots of things happening. One thing I want to let you know about, men's study this Thursday coming up at Chicken King. So that's available at 8:30. Also next week is a great opportunity for anybody who's been coming to the church, maybe for a little bit, maybe for a long time, maybe just today. It's called our Foundations class. We offer this about once a quarter or so. It's an opportunity to learn more about the church. For those that are coming, we will provide lunch for you right after church next Sunday. It's a great opportunity to come with any questions you have, questions about the Bible, questions about who we are as a church, what are our beliefs based upon the Bible, give you a chance to meet some of our staff, and just to get to know some of the other folks that are also coming. If you've never been to a Foundations class, and it's a great opportunity to come, you can come back if you've been to a Foundations class, or if you're just coming for the first time. So we encourage you to do that. We'll do lunch together, and then we'll have a little study together. It'll take us to about 2:30 next Sunday. So there's a sign-up sheet on the back for that, or just talk with me, and we'd love to have you here for that next Sunday. All right, several things going on. Please mark your calendars. We're not too far away, 2 weeks away from November and our fellowship meal, okay? So good news is once we get to November 5th, okay, so I have good news and bad news. Actually, I think it's all good news. How do you like that when somebody says it's all good news? We get an extra hour of sleep, okay? All right, so there is bad news to it. I forgot. There's bad news. The bad news is it's going to get getting darker earlier, okay? So that's coming too. But November 5th, on that Sunday, not only do you get that extra hour of sleep, but you get that extra hour to make potluck meal for the November 5th. So they'll give you an extra hour to get ready, get something ready for us. But that's just 2 weeks away. So keep that in mind on November the 5th. Please, if you have not had a chance to participate already in our shoe drive, this is for athletic shoes to help out with the homeschool group that meets here at the church. We're going to do that for just this week and next week, two more weeks through October. But there's a bag back there. It doesn't have to be new shoes, or just used shoes, but they need to be athletic shoes. So you just put those back there. That will help them towards their fundraising effort. Okay, and then other things coming up. Look for upcoming study called Rooted. Opportunities to sign up for that as well as we look to start off the new year. With some home groups and things happening, looking for people to host studies in their home and also people to lead the study and facilitating that. All right, so lots of things happening. Note the regular events through the week with our life groups that are happening through the week as well and small groups to be a part of. With that said, let's go ahead and have a word of prayer, and then we'll get right into our worship time today. Father, as we pause, I'm reminded that you're in control. And I am so very grateful Father, you're in control of events in our own lives. You're in control of, as we reach out to others, to share the love of Christ with them. You're in control of our family. You're in control of our health. You're in control of our finances. Lord, you're in control of world events. You're in control of government. You are in control, and I am so grateful. No matter what happens in life, we're reminded of the fact that God is in control. God is still on his throne. Jesus is still Lord, and we're still children of the King. Lord, I just pray that you help us this morning to focus on you, focus on your word. Lord, I just pray that you just bless Joe as he comes and shares a message today. Lord, I just pray that you use your spirit to talk to us, to speak to us, and may we worship you this morning in spirit and in truth. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I invite you now to stand and join us in singing songs of praise together. We're going to start with the song, Blessed Be Your Name, which is all about praising God no matter what circumstances we're in, whether we're in the highs of life or the lows of life. We can always sing, Blessed Be Your Name. So let's sing this together.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, those paid in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be.
we're going to continue with some good praise to the Lord with How Great Is Our God.
Thank you. As we come to a time of communion, a time to kind of gather around the Lord's table, it becomes a central focus of our worship. It's a time that we just kind of put aside distractions. It's a time that we just kind of focus in on Jesus Christ and his sacrifice upon the cross. You know, there's been much debate through the years as to how often to serve communion in church. That's been going on for a matter of centuries since the New Testament came out. Many churches across the way, and you've probably been part of those churches, they just simply celebrate periodically or whenever they kind of feel like having a special occasion for communion. Some may do it monthly, some may do it quarterly. You know, the only pattern that we have is actually from Scripture. So it's not a mandate for the year 2023 church, but we do have the New Testament Scripture. And I've really enjoyed the study that we've been able to look into the book of Acts and take a look at the New Testament church and see how they did things. Because we're going to do the best we can do to kind of pattern ourselves after the New Testament church. And because of that, we practice what they did in the New Testament church. Acts chapter 2. Verse 42, it gives us this instruction. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, which is communion, and to prayer. And so this was something that they did on a regular basis. As they came together, they shared communion. Also in the book of Acts, Acts 20, verse 7, we read these words as they gathered. Now, they gathered daily in homes, okay? They would even meet from house to house, and as they did, they would serve communion or spend time together. But it also says on the first day of the week, they had time that they came together, and we came together for the purpose of breaking bread. Now, Paul, you know, he had a sermon. He spoke to the people and did what he needed to do, but the purpose of the service was to have communion. So it's an interesting question as you kind of move on as to how often to have communion. You know, some people say, well, we don't offer it weekly because we don't want it to become routine. We don't want it to lose its special status. Well, you know, if that's our reasoning, then does that mean that we should also avoid praying too often? Or maybe we should avoid reading the Bible too much because we don't want it to become routine or lose its status. You know, that's kind of crazy. All these acts of worship don't lose their significance because we practice them too frequently. In fact, it's the opposite. It brings more meaning to it because we begin to recognize our dependence upon God as our Heavenly Father and the ongoing significance of the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus Christ in our lives, and the depth of power that is available to us and through us. And so communion isn't just special. It's the sacred centerpiece of our worship and our lives. And it reminds us certainly of the supreme sacrifice that Christ offered and the New Testament covenant that he made between God and man, that through the blood of Christ we have come to a new relationship with him. And that's made available only through the shedding of his blood. My question is that only worth celebrating occasionally when we have a pattern of the New Testament church? So when you come here to North Citrus Christian Church, you're going to see the communion laid out before you as we come together on any given Sunday, and we practice it as they did in the New Testament church as they came together on the first day of the week. And that's because there is significance to it. There is significance of what takes place during that time. So that's something that we will continue to do in its practice. But folks, it's not just about how often we take communion. Ultimately, it's about the purpose and the reason behind it. And so I just want to reference 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 28, as we prepare our minds for communion this morning. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the cup in the new covenant in my blood. And do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. So we do practice what's called open communion. That's for anybody who has stated your belief in Christ to come and share at the table of the Lord. Again, the juice is just representative of his blood, the little cracker representative of the body of Christ. We do ask that you do it in a way that's respectful and worthy as you take a look at your own life. As I take a look at my own life and realize, man, I am in need of a Savior. I need areas of my life that I need to kind of get straight. I need to kind of put them back in his hands because there's been areas I've kind of taken back to myself, and that's not good. I need to just lay them at the foot of the cross and leave them there. And so as we come together, we share with one another in a time of communion, but it's also a time that we're reflecting on our own personal relationship with Christ, just between ourselves and him. Let's pray. Father God, thank you. Thank you for the New Testament book of Acts. Thank you for the New Testament church and the pattern that it has laid out for us. And Lord, help us never to steer away from the most important centerpiece of our worship, and that is time to remember the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ through the symbolic with bread and cup, with the communion. Father, help us as we once again look into our own lives, so we once again examine ourselves before you, where we thank you so much that you have forgiven us and that you offer us that life that comes only through your name. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
How many of you have ever been wrong in your lives? Raise your hand. Those of you who just said never, the person sitting next to you, how would they answer that question for you? They would probably, what's that? I am meddling. And I should be helping people build their marriages, not give them ammunition against their spouses. Pro tip, if everyone around you is always wrong, you are probably the problem. Now I'm meddling. Okay, no one likes to be wrong, right? None of us, when we find out that we were wrong about a fact, we don't like the feeling. And so that's why a lot of times we get defensive, or we try to put on, spin it to make it sound like we are actually right when we're wrong. Like, we try to get around the fact that we are not correct. We don't like it. It's uncomfortable. It hurts our pride. It deflates our ego. Sometimes we have a negative response to being wrong because of past trauma. Like, sometimes there is, people when they're growing up, they don't have a good home environment. And so for little mistakes can lead to overreactions by those who are taking care of them. And that can leave deep physical and emotional scars. And those things can manifest later in life. Some people just are uncomfortable with rejection. If they're wrong, then they feel a sense of rejection by others, and that is unpleasant. Others think that maybe if they admit they are wrong about this one thing, that maybe what might they be wrong about other things? And they start pulling at that string, and they're afraid that if they pull on that string too much, then their whole belief system is going to unravel. And so they don't even question, or they don't admit that they are wrong. They just dig their head in the sand and pretend like everything is okay. But the problem with all of this is we believe that God is truth, that God is the author and perfecter of all good things, including truth. And if we are to be a people like God, and we are to be a people of truth, and if we willingly cling to lies, we are a bad witness to the world. Because we would rather hold on to a lie rather than hold on to God and His truth. And so it is because we have faith in Christ, because we are founded on Him, that we can allow our question or our faith or our beliefs to be corrected when they are not in alignment with a correct understanding of Scripture. It is actually a public witness of our faith to experience correction or sometimes rebuke when we are wrong about one thing or another. So how can that be? How can it be a public witness for us to endure correction and allow our beliefs and opinions to be shaped? Because if we admit our shortcomings, if we publicly admit something is wrong, aren't we going to give the enemy arrows to shoot at us? Aren't we going to give him ammunition? Are we going to give him room to accuse? Won't showing weakness be a bad thing when we should, after all, be demonstrating strength? So how can correction be a gentle witness to the world? Today we're going to be in Acts chapter 18, and hopefully we're going to be answering that question today, exploring how correction can be a good witness of Christ in the world. Now, leaving from where Jonathan preached last week, Paul left Athens and he heads to Corinth, which is just west of Athens. He meets a couple named Aquila and Priscilla, who they are also tent makers like Paul, that they have a job of building temporary structures that were often used in, say, theater productions or other public performances. So it wasn't just putting up a tent, it was like a full-on, putting everything together for some public event, stage building or props or whatever it is that was necessary. They weren't like as sophisticated as today's plays and whatnot, but they still had some things that needed to be made. And so they were tent makers. Paul was also a tent maker. And so they join forces, and Paul hangs out with them, stays with them as they engage in this trade together. And so they are all hanging out in the trade and doing ministry together. Priscilla and Aquila are Jews that had become followers of Jesus. And so Paul is there, he's hanging out in Corinth. And over time, there are two changes that we observe in Paul's life. The first one is that he stops tent making. He starts off there doing that, but then he changes course and devotes himself solely to the ministry of the word, no longer being a tent maker, but now he is 100% focused on the ministry of the word, teaching people, going into synagogues, trying to convert people to follow Jesus, to convince them that Jesus is the Savior. But after a while, he receives more trouble from Jews in the synagogues, and he turns his attention from that point on primarily to Gentiles. He has experienced the rejection of the Jewish community far too many times. He comes to the conclusion that they're not going to listen anymore. This has been, 15 years or so, 20 years. And so there is his time is better spent elsewhere. And besides that, Jesus had called him to be an apostle to the Gentiles. And so he is now fulfilling the emphasis of the ministry that Jesus had called him to anyway. And so he is now shifting his focus and attention primarily on Gentiles. And like Paul experiences often in the book of Acts, some Jews cause trouble for him, especially those who are in power. They round up crowds to go against him, and Paul has to leave town. And then he goes on traveling, and we pick up in verse 18, where Luke tells us that Paul stayed on in Corinth for some time, and then he left the brothers and sisters and sailed for Syria, accompanied by Priscilla and Aquila. Before he sailed, he had his hair cut off in because of a vow he had taken. They arrived at Ephesus, where Paul left Priscilla and Aquila. He himself went into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. When they asked him to spend more time with them, he declined. But as he left, he promised, "I will come back if it's God's will." And then he set sail from Ephesus. So Paul is bringing along Priscilla and Aquila to Ephesus, but then he goes on and he leaves them there to conduct ministry while he travels on elsewhere. Now, I find it fascinating that Paul has set his mind to minister primarily to the Gentiles, but he can't help himself but to, once again, go into a synagogue and try to convince Jews. It's like he knows where his focus should be, but he's, maybe a little bit distractible and continues to go that. He still loves his fellow countrymen. He still desires that they come to faith in Jesus. And so he begins, and they welcome him for a time there, and they desire to hear more about Jesus, so that we see that they're open. They want to hear about Jesus, and that is a good thing. So he is happy to oblige for a time. And so Paul is he's left Priscilla and Aquila there. Now, before we follow Paul on his journey, there are some important things to note about the city of Ephesus. The city, despite having a Jewish synagogue, it has a relatively low Jewish population. There is some evidence from his history that they had a decent-sized Jewish population, but by far and large, it was a Gentile area. That it had two primary temples. The primary deity of the city, the principal deity, was the goddess Artemis. They had a large temple and religious system built up in that city to worship her. They also had a temple to Emperor Augustus, who was the emperor of the empire from 27 BC to AD 14. And so they literally worshipped the Roman emperor as God. Now, this is a little bit of foreshadowing that we're not going to get to in our text, but saying that there is only one God is going to be a truth that a culture And Ephesus is going to have a hard time accepting, because they're used to worshiping Artemis and all these other gods, including emperor. When Paul comes into town and says that there is only one God, people are not going to take it kindly. So we continue reading in verse 22. When he landed at Caesarea, he went up to Jerusalem and greeted the church, and then went down to Antioch. After spending some time in Antioch, Paul set out from there and traveled from place to place throughout the region of Galatia and Phrygia, strengthening all of the disciples. So Paul takes a quick trip to Jerusalem and then heads up north to Antioch. And then he goes up further north to the area of Galatia and Phrygia, where he is going there to strengthen Christians, where there are already churches established. In your scriptures, in your Bibles, oftentimes it says like little headings, Paul's first, second, and third missionary journey. And we have this impression that Paul is going there and everywhere he's going is converting new Christians, which in some cases is true, but his third missionary journey is primarily to help strengthen believers who are already believers, not necessarily to evangelize new people in the kingdom, although that does take place. Now, it might seem like talking about these different areas is just a little filler that Luke is using, a little throwaway statement to set up the context for what is happening next. But remember, words, ink, paper were all expensive in that day. And so everything that Luke tells us, he wants us to know. It's important. And so Paul is traveling around strengthening disciples. And this is a very important job and role that he is doing. And you might say, well, why? What's the point? Haven't they already had an apostle, spent significant time with them, teaching them about Jesus? They have already heard the gospel. What more could they know? I mean, Paul's already spent a lot of time, blood, sweat, and tears, teaching them. Shouldn't they know everything already? Shouldn't that be enough? But we recognize, hey, so what? Little heads up. Sometimes what I do when I'm creating my slides is I will take last week's presentation and I will massage in this week's content. And sometimes I leave stuff from last time in there. So sometimes I have to make little notes. Oh, I made a mistake. I was wrong. Point is, discipleship is a lifelong journey. It's not something that you just hear one time and you're done. You're not just saved and converted and that's it. It's not like you get your get-out-of-hell-free card and you put that in your wallet and you go on and you never learn anything new about Jesus ever. Discipleship is a lifelong journey. There are limits to how much somebody can teach and how much somebody can learn in any given amount of time. And we all forget things. I used to have professors in seminary that we would joke about that they have forgotten more about the Bible than we will ever know, which is true. But that's just also a sly way of saying everybody forgets something. We often have to relearn things that we already knew at one point or another, at least be reminded about it. But not only that, sometimes we have new questions. We encounter different situations in life and we're like, well, what does God have to say about this? How does this relate to Scripture? How does this relate to Jesus? Or we have different doubts that arise. Like for the disciples who were in Ephesus, like they're eventually going to have some difficulty in their culture and in the worship of different gods. And they're going to have to wrestle with the fact that eventually they're going to be told, you either offer a pinch of incense to worship Caesar or you're dead. And they're going to wonder, how do we manage that situation? How do we walk with Jesus when we have the whole culture telling us, bow to our idols or die? You know, how do we handle that? And so there are different elements where, especially where persecution is happening, where Paul is going and strengthening them and helping them come to terms with the struggles that they're facing in life to connect their struggles with the gospel of Jesus. And so he's helping them understand trials and temptations and how they relate so that those things don't pull Christians away from Jesus. And not only that, but you also have false teachers who are going around causing confusion. Especially Paul's going around in this area of Galatia. He has to write a letter to the church in Galatia at some point because there are a lot of people going around telling them that you have to, not only have to believe in Jesus, but you also have to observe the entire law of Moses. Which, as we talked about a few weeks ago in the Jerusalem Council, they've already decided that's a no-go. And so he has to go back, because these false teachers are coming around, he has to come back, not only write a letter, but visit them and say, no, you guys, that's wrong. This is the way of Jesus. So to help clarify things. And so it's not just a one-and-done thing. Discipleship is an ongoing process. And we understand that. For anybody of you who is a green thumb, we're brown thumbs. If you're a green thumb, you recognize that once you have a seed that you plant and it grows into a plant, that yes, it's healthy, but there are things that you have to do to continue for that plant to be healthy. If you have a grapevine, you still have to prune it and do all sorts of things so that it continues to produce grapes. If you have a tree, you have to trim off the dead branches, and not only just to make it look good, but to also keep rot and other things from setting in. You have to maintain the health of the plant so that it continues to grow and bear fruits. And that is exactly what it's like for us in our faith. We don't just get saved. We also have to continue to be fed and watered and nurtured so that we continue to grow and walk in our faith with Jesus. I remember one time, for a good portion of our ministry in West Virginia, in our area, there was an influx of, well, I'll call them flat out, false teachers. People are coming in and teaching a false gospel that was centered around fake healings and promised miracles and lots of revivals and stuff. And there was a lot of crazy things happening in a lot of the different community events that were going on. And so because of the challenge of faith, you know, it contradicted the doctrines and beliefs of our church. Some people were having doubts and questions. Well, do we really believe this? You know, what is going on in these services? And so we had to take some time to address these different false teachers who were getting popular in our community because we had people with doubts and questions, and there were issues being caused in our congregation. And that's kind of similar to what Paul was doing in some of these journeys, some of these travels. That sometimes we just have to stop and address different situations as they arise to help disciples of Jesus grow in their faith so that they can be strong. But that is a process. That is something that comes throughout our entire lives. That's what that sound is. I keep hitting my mic pack and it keeps making a boom. Okay. Sorry, I'm distractible. So that's what Paul has been up to. Now, what about the people that he's left in Ephesus? Sorry, I'm also operating on a little bit of sleep, and so when I get a little bit of sleep, I get loopy. So we will, and I'm over-caffeinated, so that's a really awesome combination. Meanwhile, and verse 24, meanwhile, a Jew named Apollos, a native of Alexandria, came to Ephesus. He was a learned man with a thorough knowledge of the Scripture. He had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and he spoke with great fervor and taught about Jesus accurately. Though he only knew the baptism of John, he began to speak boldly in a synagogue. When Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they invited him to their home and explained to him the way of God more adequately. So here we are introduced to a man named Apollos. This is where we got the name of our son. Our oldest child, Apollos, comes from this passage. He is very smart. He's passionate about preaching about Jesus. He teaches about Jesus accurately. He is able to teach the Jews from Scripture who Jesus is. But there is a huge gap in his knowledge that actually has serious theological implications. That is, somehow, in all of his learning, in all of his time as a follower of Jesus, he only knows about the baptism of John. He did not know about the baptism of Jesus, or what we would say, being baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, Zach and I were joking this morning. We had a Trail Life camp out last night. I woke up, and I looked kind of like John the Baptist. My hair was all a mess. And I said, I should have said, and I told him we're joking, like, I should not brush my hair so that I could emphasize this point. Because John was a wild man who wore camel's hair and all that kind of stuff, and he ate locusts and honey. He was a man of the wilderness. So it would have been hilarious. But I know what I've gotten comments from some of y'all, so we didn't go there. So anyway, so he only knows of the baptism of John, not the baptism of Jesus. And you say, what's the difference? What does it matter? And I want to say, And I don't mean this meanly, but sometimes we de-emphasize baptism. We say it's just an outward sign of an inward faith. If that were true, why is it so important that Apollos get corrected on what he believes about baptism? If it's just an outward sign, what does it matter? You're doing the thing anyway. What does it matter? But let us understand a little bit from Scripture what we're talking about. The baptism of John. We learn about what the baptism of John is when we read Mark chapter 1, where Mark tells us that John the Baptist is going around in the wilderness calling people to repent. And he says, repent and be baptized into the forgiveness of your sins. So John preached a baptism of repentance, meaning that in order to express your repentance and to receive forgiveness of sins, that you are immersed into water by some other person. And it is clear from the preaching of John that it wasn't just that you believe and your sins are gone. It is having submitted yourself to that, God in that moment is forgiving your sins as you repent in that moment. And it's very clear in the Greek grammar when you look at it, that is what John is preaching. And that would have been insane in their day, because where in their culture did you go to have your sins forgiven? You went to the temple and you did what? Offered what? A sacrifice of bread? An animal, blood. Yes, living blood. So we recognize that John starts something different in that society. In that culture, to them, that would have been crazy, because forgiveness of sins happens at the temple, not in the Jordan River. And so John is starting something new. He's preparing a way for Jesus, and he's beginning to get the people to go down a different path to be ready for Jesus. And God, through John, was creating something new that was different from the Jewish temple system, from the Jewish, even the ritual washings that they engaged in. And so that is the baptism of John that Apollos knew, but he didn't know about the baptism of Jesus. The clearest meaning of this comes from Acts chapter 2, where Peter is on the day of Pentecost preaching about Jesus. The Jewish people are convicted about their guilt in putting Jesus to the death, and they ask Peter, what do we do? And Peter says, repent and be baptized, which is like John, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so, like John, sins are forgiven, but in the baptism of Christ, we have the Holy Spirit, we have the promise of eternal life, and we recognize that it is not the waters of the Jordan that is cleansing us, but it is the blood of Christ himself offered on the cross that is cleansing us, that we are, by faith, are receiving. And so Apollos gets to understand like how and when people get the Holy Spirit, when the promise of eternal life is given. And Peter says that this promise is for you, your children, and those who are far off. This promise is for the Gentiles. And so this is an opportunity for Priscilla and Aquila to help correct Apollos so that he can more accurately preach about Jesus and present the gospel. And so as they hear Apollos, he is speaking inaccurately, what do they do? How do they handle this situation? How they handle this is very instructive. Do they stand up in front of everybody as Apollos is speaking and say, hey guys, everybody, Apollos, your theology is messed up. You're mistaken. You're a fool. You're an idiot. Shouldn't you know this by now? Hey, everybody, stop listening to Apollos. He's not speaking the truth accurately. So now he is marked as a false teacher, so avoid him, please. Do they do any of that? Do they call him out in public? Do they make him to act or feel like a fool? Do they do that? How do they handle the situation? What they do is they invite him over to their home, and they gently explain to him the way of God more accurately. They don't publicly shame him. They don't publicly humiliate him. They invite him over for some snacks, probably a meal, hanging out, discussing their ministry, talking about the Word of God, and they take an opportunity to explain the way of Jesus more accurately in a more comfortable situation. Now, there are times when public rebuke is necessary. We read about that in a lot of Paul's writings, where he will specifically by name call people out when they have gone so far off the path that they need to be corrected publicly, or when they've caused so much damage in the congregation as a whole that it really needs to be addressed publicly. So there are times for that. But as a general rule, the way of operation for us should be like this, is that they are approaching this correction in an atmosphere of hospitality and friendship in their homes, a place where it is comfortable. And this is a really awesome environment. And I want to have a brief commercial for our Rooted study that we're going to be beginning in January, where we're going to be meeting together for study in homes. This is a wonderful opportunity for us to gather around in smaller groups to get to know each other better, to understand the Word of God more accurately together, just like we see happening here with Apollos and Priscilla and Aquila, like we see Jesus conducted in his own earthly ministry. As Jonathan mentioned, the churches, they met together from house to house so that they can learn and build community and friendship and fellowship, so that we can help one another grow in these closer relationships, because it is within these environments that we grow the best and grow the most, because we can have some good, deep conversations like they're happening here. Now, there's some really cool things that are happening in this passage, a couple of minor details. I want to point out that it might seem mundane details, but they're actually important in their culture and even in ours. The first time that Luke mentions Aquila and Priscilla, he mentions Aquila first and then Priscilla, his wife. But then the next two times he mentions this couple, he says Priscilla first, and Aquila, the husband, second, in a male-dominated society. That was not by accident. He was sending a subtle message. Also note that, so that would have broke their social norms. Also note that as they are gathering together to correct Apollos, you have a husband and his wife getting together to teach a prominent leader in the church the right way of doctrine. And what I like about this is sometimes little details like this don't fit neatly into our theological boxes. Sometimes God is pushing us a little bit outside of our comfort zone. It also reminds me of how thankful I am of my wife, Sarah, that she and I are like a tag team duo, that she also is very smart in the scripture, sometimes smarter than me. And so what I really appreciate about her is a lot of people go to her for biblical advice and counseling, understanding scripture. She likes to teach others as well. And so I'm glad that I have a Priscilla, which I will never call her that, as my wife. And so we can work together in ministry. And so that is something that I appreciate about her. So again, there are times when public rebuke is necessary, but as a general rule, we should practice gentle correction with the goal of helping the person along the path of discipleship. They're not there to tear them down. They're there to model grace. Apollos there is demonstrating the humility of being teachable. This follows Jesus' example of how we learn and grow as followers of Jesus. It follows Jesus' example of how he was gentle and kind most of the time to his disciples. Sometimes he got a little bit pointed with Peter, especially when Peter says, "Nah, you're not going to die." And Jesus said, "Get behind me, Satan." But most of the time, he is extremely patient with them. Jesus is patient with us as we learn and grow, and so we ought to be patient with others as they learn and grow. Now, in construction, as I work in the construction industry, oftentimes we make mistakes. If you've ever had a contractor build a house or do some work in your house, you know that there are oftentimes mistakes, things that we get wrong. Now, sometimes when we are doing things, maybe we're distracted, maybe we have bad information, maybe the blueprints are wrong, or maybe one of our coworkers gives us the wrong instructions, or maybe we're given a wrong part that we have to try to make work. Maybe we don't have a proper understanding of the outcome, and so we don't go engage in the process. But whatever the reason, there are times when we mess up. And sometimes our coworker will discover our mistake. And generally, they're not kind about it. They will usually say, I'm going to try not to say the full phrase, because I hear it so much. What the is this? Like, they're cursing at you. What the is wrong with this? In other words, or who the did this? I want to find this person so I can chew them out so that they will again make the same mistake next time and I will chew them out again. Right? We are not kind to one another when we make mistakes in the construction industry. The other day we were working at a job site and someone else, a different person in a different trade, come up to a problem that I don't think we made, but he said that the phrase, "What happened here?" I'm like, it wasn't me. Keep on with our job, you know? Like, you know, there's just this complete and utter lack of grace in the construction industry. And you develop some thick skin over a while, but sometimes, something is an eighth of an inch off over 20 feet, and somebody's, like, noticing the little detail, and they make a huge deal out of it. It's like, dude, like, if there are some instances, like, where it's all right to be upset when the front wall is 16 inches higher than the back wall because the block person didn't lay two courses of block. Like, that's a big mistake that you can be upset about. But if it's just a little bit, like, people sometimes get so upset. So sometimes, oftentimes, it's not gentle. It's often mean. It's very arrogant. And oftentimes, it is to put somebody else down to make somebody else feel better about themselves, to put themselves in a more superior position. But the way of Jesus is different. In Galatians chapter 2, Paul says this, "Brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person harshly, meanly, with arrogance. You idiot, why did you make that mistake? Shouldn't you know better? You've been following Jesus for 50 years. Get your act together." Restore that person gently. But watch yourselves, or you may also be tempted. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. Right? Correct each other gently, but also have some humility to know that you can also get sucked into that sin too. So again, there's this correcting with gentleness, but there's also this interplay of humility. So when we practice this kind of correction that Paul is describing here and what we read about in Acts, it is notably different from how the world does things. And they will notice. If we are acting different, they will say, "Whoa, that's different." It'll be like night and day different. And they will notice that is so weird. They'll say, "Hey, they actually care for one another. They're there to help one another rather than tear each other down. They're there to encourage each other." That is... Well, some people might say it's cool, some people might say that's weak, but we don't care if they say it's weak, but it's good, it's holy, it's pleasing to God. And so, changing how we deal with inaccurate teaching and correcting and how we correct others can go a long way in our hypercritical world. We're so critical about everything. And if we can practice this kind of gentle correction, it will be a great witness in the world. And it will have a positive difference in our lives and lives of others and the lives of those who hear the gospel. Now let's fast forward to verse 27. Continue reading in verse 27. See how this plays out. "So Apollos went on to Achaia. The brothers and sisters encouraged him and wrote to the disciples there to welcome him. When he arrived, he was a great help to those who by grace had believed. For he vigorously refuted his Jewish opponents in public debate, proving from the scripture that Jesus was the Messiah." So Apollos wants to go over to Greece, and he uses his gifts in an area that includes Athens and Corinth, and he wants to go over there. And so he goes, but the brothers and sisters, they send a letter with him. Not a letter that points out, yeah, he's a good teacher, but he had this problem. You might want to overlook that. No, they send a letter of encouragement to say how good of a person he is. And I'm sure that must have been embarrassing for Apollos to bring that letter with him. Like, "Guys, I got this letter with me. you might want to read it in private. I don't want to hear what's in it. You know, it's sometimes hard to hear good things about yourself. And so he's probably feeling a little bit embarrassed. But they send this letter of encouragement, not condemnation. They're not holding his prior ignorance against him. They're encouraging him. And so the correction was well received by Apollos. It was, and how it happened, it was well. How it was received was well done. But in the process, because of how it was done, Apollos did not get beat up and discouraged. In fact, he was better equipped to spread the gospel and was more effective in doing so because of the gentle correction that he received. So gentle correction enables people to be better witnesses of the gospel, because what they are going to teach is more in line with the gospel. That they are going to, the confusion that they have is going to be lessened. They're going to experience a greater amount of truth that they are going to be more confident in proclaiming towards others. Because they know that what they believe is correct, that before they were incorrect, but now they know that what they're saying is true. And so they can speak with more boldness and confidence in what they are saying. And that is a result of them going in and stepping in and correcting them in a kind and gentle way. Now, last night when we were gathered together for our Tree of Life campout, there was some kids who were starting the campfire. But they were not doing it correctly. They were getting a little bit ahead of themselves. They were really excited to build the fire. And so they were like lighting up the tinder and the kindling really quick, but they hadn't like built the full structure of the thing because they, you know, they're pyros, which I respect, and they're wanting the fire. So they weren't quite doing it right. But what I saw from several of the fathers who had gathered there is they didn't, oh, you guys are idiots, you don't know what you're doing. They step in and ask questions to help them understand the process, think through what they're doing, and to guide them in doing it better, not just then, but so that they can learn for the next time they get together and build a fire. Gentle correction to give them confidence, give them instruction, give them confidence to do it better next time. And so we want people, as followers of Jesus, to be more confident in their faith and knowledge. We want them to grow in their abilities. We want to guide them to meet those goals. And it's important that we act with those goals in mind, not just that we are acting like we know everything, like we are right, we just want people to be right, but our goal, our heart should be to help people to be better disciples of Jesus. I've known a lot of people in ministry who have left ministry because there are people in the church who thought it was their job to humble the minister, the preacher, the youth minister, the worship minister by always pointing out every terrible, bad thing that they did, every note that they sang off key, every bad decision that they made. They had people there to tear them down, to point out every single mistake that they made. It was their job to beat humility into somebody. But what is more effective is doing like Priscilla and Aquila, walking beside them, helping them grow, instructing them kindly and gently, building them up rather than tearing others down. And when we do that, we are being better disciple makers. We ourselves are growing in our ability as disciple makers, and those people are becoming better disciples of Jesus. So how can gentle correction be a witness? Well, gentle correction itself is grace and truth in action. The grace of Jesus being performed in how the correction is done, in truth, in the correctness of what is being taught. So you have this beautiful marriage of grace and truth. It is a living demonstration of Jesus' life in our own time. As we model the way of Jesus, people can see Jesus through how we act and treat each other. It shows that Jesus' people actually do care for one another, that they're there to build each other up, not to tear each other down. That we care enough about people that we are going to help them grow in their knowledge, in their faith. That we care enough to practice gentleness instead of harshness. And so, let's be like Aquila and Priscilla. Let's be like Apollos. Let's allow, let's be willing, let's be committed to letting the truth shape our beliefs. Let's allow ourselves to submit to the truth of God and His Word. But let's do so that we can help understand the Word of God more accurately. Let's humbly accept it when we are corrected, when we are wrong, and allow ourselves to grow and be shaped by God. But let us model the grace of Jesus through our gentle correction, so that the world can see the grace of Jesus in action through us. And may that witness, through our gentle correction, bring them closer to Him, or even accept faith for the first time. So church, let's be humble ourselves, let's be gentle, let's practice the way of Jesus in how we correct and receive correction. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for the kindness that You give to us each and every day. We're so grateful that we deserve so much wrath and anger from You. But we are so grateful that Your patience. Over hundreds and thousands of years has You guided Your people to bring Jesus in this world, that You are kind and patient with them over and over again. And when we sin over and over again, You are patient with us. I pray that You would help us to practice that same patience towards one another. Help us to practice the gentleness of Christ in how we approach correction with one another. Help us to not be afraid or shy in proclaiming Your truth and helping people to grow in their faith, but help us to be people who are kind and gentle, not mean-spirited or critical or bitter, but just help us to be people who want what is best for other people and help us to act in accordance with that. And Father, I pray this morning for anybody who needs to experience Your grace for the first time, that they need to have their sins washed away. They need to have the gift of eternal life. I pray that they would understand Your kindness and they would understand Your gentleness today. Maybe they're afraid of You because of their sin. Maybe they're ashamed. Father, I pray that You would help remove that fear, remove that shame, and that they would accept Your love and grace today as they give themselves to You and allow You to forgive their sins, wash them away, and give them eternal life. We pray these things in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. So today we are going to offer an invitation for you to follow Jesus. All of us really should respond in that way. As we understand the way of Jesus, that Jesus calls us on a lifestyle of discipleship, during this time, whatever decision that you have to make with Jesus along that path, I challenge you to make it. If it is accepting correction, changing, allowing God to shape and mold your beliefs and mold your discipleship, I pray that you would submit that to Him today. Or if it's accepting His grace and forgiveness of sins for the first time today, come forward today and let's make that happen so that you can experience the gift of the Holy Spirit and the promise of eternal life. But let's go ahead and stand and sing our invitation song together today.
While Joe's on back, going back to the drums, I'd just like to acknowledge the Trail of Life Boys Group, BSA. Scott, who just came in, and Zach and Joe, they all camped out. Being an old Boy Scout, I'm sure they didn't get a lot of sleep, like Joe said. But it's so great for the boys, learning about God, learning a lot of skills. As old as I am, I remember some of the things, and it's just a great thing. So just thank you guys for doing that. Really appreciative.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. All your ways are good. All your ways are sure. I will trust. I will follow you, yeah, light unto the world, light unto my life. I will live for you alone, you're the one I see, knowing I will find all I need. In you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. Where you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. In you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom for my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. And I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you.
Alrighty, I want to thank you guys for coming out. Now is the real work of the church begins, and that's to go out those doors and make a difference in the people's lives that you come across to this given week. And I believe that God's going to put some people in your path, just like Paul and Apollos and Priscilla and Aquila ran into. I think he'll put people in your path as well. So let's have our closing prayer, and then we'll have our course. Father God, I just thank you for giving us wisdom, how to give and how to accept gentle correction. Father, we need wisdom in that area. And Father, just to give us the words we need to say, to speak the truth in love. But Lord, help us also to have an open heart and an open mind to receiving words from others that we need to be corrected ourselves. Father, help us now as you send us forth to do the work of the church. Lord, help us as you bring people into our path just to be faithful to you and to point them to your Son, Jesus Christ. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah.
All right, have a great week, everybody.